Time now to head into the chat room, and joining me today is Nine's Lisa Fernandez in Perth and Mix 104.9 radio host Katie Wolf in Darwin. A big welcome to both of you ladies today.
Hi, ladies.
Good afternoon, ladies.
Now, first up today, we do have to start on a serious note. Of course, the horrific Manchester bombing early this week. In the light of that, several media outlets have made the decision not to publish or broadcast the man's name who was responsible for it. Now, it's part of a bigger movement not to glorify terrorists. Even Donald Trump has refused to label those responsible as monsters because he says it's exactly what they want to hear. Let's go first to you, Katie. Do you think we should be keeping these terrorists anonymous? We say that as we put a photo of him up there, quite ironic, but what do you think?
Listen, I totally understand the sentiment here that we don't want to be glorifying these horrendous people, but it's our job, I think, as journalists, as reporters, as broadcasters, to make sure that we are presenting the facts, even when they are horrific facts. That is our job. It's not our job to sanitise the news. It's not our job to pick and choose the elements of the news that we do and don't broadcast. And I do agree that we shouldn't be glorifying terrorists. There is absolutely no doubt about that. But I don't think that if we don't name them, it's going to stop them from performing these horrendous acts.
Yeah, you make a very good point, and I couldn't help but think the community sort of has a right to know too. You'd want answers, you'd want to know what happened, you'd want to know if that person had been living near you. I don't know, Lisa, what do you think?
So you girls both come from a news perspective, I see. No, I agree. I don't want to see the picture. Maybe name them, but you know what? Let's show the pictures of the victims. Let's honour the victims by seeing them. I'm not news. I'm a presenter, and I was just a radio broadcaster, so I have nothing to do with news. I am so infuriated when we do have these tragic stories and the first thing you see is a person who is a suicide bomber or the person that killed the people. I hate it. Just from a public perspective, I think a lot of the public hate it. They don't want to see that. What about the victims? Even when people are murdered, even when people are raped, it's always the person who's done it. There's like a tiny picture of the victim. Like, the most important person here is the victim. The victims in this case. I don't give a stuff about what that bloke looks like. I don't actually even want to know his name. Don't care. I want to know more about the people, their stories, you know, who was affected, and the brothers and sisters of these kids. That's honestly what I want to know about. So I hate it when news outlets do that. First put up the person who did it.
Yeah, look, you make a very good point, Lisa, and I think a lot of people feel exactly the same way as you do, and I think this movement is hopefully designed to remember and commemorate the amazing people that were the unfortunate victims of such a horrific, horrific attack. As Katie says, as newscasters, it's hard not to provide all the information, but from an audience point of view, as families and mums and dads, I completely understand the sentiment of just not wanting to even go there, and especially for other potential terrorists or suicide bombers, you don't want them to think that their name is going to and photo is going to be slashed all over the world.
I do agree with that, but I think then if we're outlying every other aspect of the attack, but then just not mentioning their name, well, it sort of defeats the purpose. You know, if we're going to start to editorialise and only put forward different facts of the story that we think are appropriate, isn't it up to our listeners, our viewers, our readers to pick and choose what they do and don't want to hear?
Yeah. All right, we do have to move on. And, well, if you want a big family, you should pay for it yourself. That's according to one Gold Coast doctor who earlier this week spoke, and it certainly garnered lots of attention. He said people who are unable to afford children should not be handed incentives to have more. But where would this leave us as a society? So if childcare rebates and family payments cut out, say, after two kids, could Australia head down the route of China's one-child policy, perhaps where one or two kids were accepted here, and big families would all but disappear except for the very wealthy? Lisa, what's your view? Should people be allowed to have as many kids as they like, even if it is paid for by taxpayers?
Okay, look, this is a huge subject, one I actually do feel very passionately about, but I will say it's got to do with education. For those people who are on welfare benefits already and are having children, I think we really need to care a little bit more and help them a little bit more and educate them. Maybe these women don't have enough money to afford the pill, so they're not on contraception, you know, or they don't understand that, you know, you do need to take the pill at these times every day, otherwise you're going to fall pregnant again and then you're going to stay in that welfare cycle. okay? So I think it's got to do with education. I don't think a whole blanket thing about taking money away is going to fix the problem, okay? But I will say that, you know, I've got two kids by two separate dads and I've always paid my own way and I'm really proud of that fact, but not everyone's in my financial situation, not everyone's in my social situation. You have people that are very disadvantaged who, you know, are in this cycle of they've got four children, their sister has four children, someone else has six children, so it's completely normal for them, right, to get these benefits. And by stopping them, you're just going to hurt the families and hurt the kids. So it's all about education, getting in there and helping them and showing them, okay, you know, your three kids can only have this sort of a life because this is all that you can afford. Why would you then have another child? Let's talk about this. How can we help you not have another child?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It certainly does, Lisa. And, you know, it has to be acknowledged you work very, very hard for those two kids.
Yeah.
Yes. So good on you for doing that. I know, just the hours you work. Katie, what do you think?
I can't believe people don't actually take into account before they have children just how expensive it is and just how, you know, how much hard work it is. Because as the three of us know, as mums that work very hard, it is a real juggle financially and time-wise to be parents. So I'm surprised that people don't put more thought into that before they do have kids. But it's also worth pointing out that there are some big families out there that well and truly pay their own way. You know, my sister-in-law is one of five children and they are all wonderful children. You know, the parents have done an amazing job at raising all of those kids and making sure that they are all very well educated. But you don't want families that are totally and utterly reliant on welfare.
And I think it comes back to what Lisa perhaps said is about education, and that perhaps while you might get welfare breaks when the child is born, you have to bring this child up till they're at least 18.
That's right.
Let's face it, 30 these days because they never leave home.
So expensive.
Certainly. I don't think necessarily is the answer. We do have to leave it there. We're going to take a break and come back to our panel in just a moment. Welcome back to the chat room with Lisa Fernandez and Katie Wolfe. And Aussie kids have no idea about money when they leave school, according to one mum who has been scathing about Australia's maths education. She says kids should be learning about finances and loans so when they finish school, they know how to use a bank account, take out a loan and pay rent. Katie, should we be ditching algebra in favour of financial literacy in our schools?
Can I take the class? I think it's probably a good idea. You know, really, we need to be learning more about the practicalities of money rather than the really sort of difficult algebra and things like that.
What, Lisa, what do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. My daughter's seven and she's clueless, really. I mean, she's not. I mean, she's just an airhead. And so it would really, really help if they taught her actually useful things so that she doesn't end up dependent on me. And, you know, actually, to be honest with you, while you're at it, let's just lose human bio. Because really, let's be honest, who's ever used it after high school? Name one person. Human biology, have you?
Oh,
did
right.
Did you ever use it? Did you ever use it? Amber, really, after
I liked
high
it
school,
as a...
did you use human biology?
Well, no.
Just English for me, really, you know. I think you're either good at one or good at the other, English or maths.
That's right. I actually didn't even do maths for Year 12 because I was so crap at it.
Yes, there you go. So bad.
But we're great journalists. You can only be good at, can't be good at everything. Katie and Lisa, we love having you on chat room. Thank you so much for your opinions. We'll chat to you soon.
Okay, bye.